Welcome back to the Imaginary Gallery. It's TJ, your host, and I bring you Narcissist Trash Talk. This discussion applies to the Narcissist as well as the other creatures within the Cluster B spectrum. The topic of the evening is the Narcissist has no depth. That's right, no depth. This kind of connects on to a recent video that I had put out, the toxic person test, where you ask the creature to take you through its thought process, which if you've got a Cluster B creature, it more than likely couldn't do it, or if it did, it was not convincing. This ties into that, has to do with the lack of depth. And when I'm saying depth, it doesn't necessarily mean that they lack extreme deep knowledge of some scientific theory, philosophy, or things like that. Of course, it could include that. When I say depth, I'm referring to more than just being on the surface. Like when you ask them, oh, what do you think of this? If you get an answer every time you ask,
oh, it was good. The movie? Oh, it was cute. The song? Oh, it was good.
Well, that doesn't really tell you anything. There's no depth. It ties into the lesson I'd learned back in creative writing class, I believe in high school. The teacher had told us, you've got to show the reader, don't tell. So the lesson was called Show,
Don't Tell.
Showing would be involving depth, but it's a good example or parallel. If you were writing, for example, a creative writing story, and you stated, Sophia walked into the room, she was beautiful. You're telling the reader. If you're reading that, Sophia walked into the room, she's beautiful. It's really not going to mean much to you, because what's beautiful? That's in the eye of the beholder. Instead, the teacher would instruct us to show the reader, which would be more like, Sophia walked into the room, the moonlight against her skin cast a luminous glow, almost like milk. Her eyelashes were long and curled, her emerald green eyes sparkled in the moonlight. Her skin was smooth all the way down. A low-cut shirt revealed two melon-sized breasts that radiated off the moonlight. I mean, those are just ridiculous examples, but you're actually seeing it when you're reading. They're showing you. Well, these creatures seem to just want to tell. They don't know how to show because they're fake. They're usually reciting somebody else's words instead of their own, which indicates that they don't have anything really about them that's truly theirs. Aside from a few things like they might like certain foods, as far as personality-wise, they are fluid. They change from one extreme to the other based on who they're trying to target. In addition to the test you gave, you also may notice that someone you spent a lot of time with doesn't say a lot. I've noticed this on a few occasions where I would get involved with one of these people that turned out to be a creature, and a lot of times it would start off where I'd just do all the talking about everything. I can go into depth about all kinds of subjects more than they want to know about. And of course that ties into when I do that, the person would be like interested.
Oh, really?
Because they're lacking any type of depth, they would just usually say,
oh, that's nice. Oh, that's interesting.
Or just say nothing and then later say,
oh, your stories are very interesting.
But they don't contribute. They don't say, oh, that story was great. Well, listen to this one. They'll also, in my experience, will come up with these phrases that indicate they heard someone else say this phrase that's a blanket type statement that's all-encompassing. Such as,
today when you went to that grocery store and you bought that one item, the line you stood in and everything you did, that will change the rest of your life and affect it all.
Which might catch your attention, but then I would try to bounce it back and say, really? So if there were two boxes of sugar on the shelf and I picked this one rather than that one, it's going to make a real big difference for the rest of my life?
Yes.
But there'd be nothing else to it, which makes me think they heard somebody else say it, or it was in a movie or something, and they wanted to appear to be like a human being, so they said it, but they can't qualify it. And then it contradicts other things they do later in many cases. Or you may find yourself with the silent type, and you think that they're deep-thinking, silent types that just don't say a lot. If you're around them enough, when they're trying to isolate you, you end up spending a lot of time with them, which sometimes works to their disadvantage, because then it gives you more time to examine them. They're examining you, you might as well examine them, but they can not to handle it because you're hearing them make a big statement and then you're trying to open up the discussion to say, but wait a second, what about other circumstances? And they don't have anything else to say. Or, like I said, they won't say anything except just listen to what you say and respond. Because I didn't hear a lot of stuff, I got after one once because I had thought all along, oh, there must be something there, I just can't wait to hear it. I wonder when it's coming. Years and years passed and it never came. What I sat it down once and said is like, look, I could pick a subject, interesting or not, and I could sit you down and I could just say, hey, I'm going to talk to you about this subject. And I would do it. I said, why don't you ever do that about anything? It doesn't have to be anything necessarily important, just something important to the person. Because that allows you to make more sense of your world by connecting with the person you're with, not necessarily agreeing with it, but at least seeing where they're coming from and understanding them, which would be helpful when you meet these creatures who pretend to be a certain way when you first meet them. In words, they tell you,
oh, I'm a very compassionate person.
And then you see them walk down the beach and see a person of a different race, and they call it a name and throw a rock at it. Well, that's not compassion. Imagine if this happens in real life, and it is a real person. They might say,
oh, well, I do respect everyone except that particular race.
Then it would make a little bit of sense. But typically, it's,
I respect everyone.
And then you see that, and then they give you a dumb excuse.
Oh, well, that was a whatever race, so I did it to them because of...
You're thinking, okay, I would have appreciated then when you told me you're polite to everyone and respectful. You should have just said,
I'm racist. I hate this particular race, but other than that, I'm a great person to everybody.
But that's never done. They just make it up as they go along, unfortunately. But it's very frustrating because I'd been with that one and said, why don't you ever elaborate about anything? The response was,
well, that's not my personality. That's just not who I am.
It doesn't have anything to do with who you are. Do you have a brain? Does it process thoughts? Well, share them. But it's very difficult for these people, and it really hurts you. This is what I have? Oh, I've been tricked. Because you think, oh my goodness, I've wasted all this time with this person. And then a lot of times we don't want to believe that, so we try to tell ourselves, oh, I'm just being too critical. Oh, the person's all right, and we had these fun times, and it's very conflicting and cognitive dissonance creating and frustrating. I will also share an example of what it looks like when you're dealing with one of these people that lacks depth. I happen to have experienced it myself. I was with this person. It was the long-term one. In the very beginning, things happened like holidays. I think the first one was Valentine's Day. This creature that I didn't know was a creature yet had given like a card, and all it said inside was, Happy Valentine's Day, with an M, and that's it. Now mine, of course, was much more detailed. Much more depth was in it. Because I was genuinely fooled by this love-bombing idealization, I was saying things like, I think it's so great that we met each other, I have such a fun time with you, it's great that we're going on this vacation, and we have these sweet little dogs, and oh, it's just a great family, and all this stuff like that. That was just my natural way of expressing whatever I felt for the Valentine's Day. Well, that was like the first example, and remember, the other person's card just said, Happy Valentine's Day. Well, after I did this, there was like a birthday or some other celebration that came up later, and miraculously, the card that I got that time pretty much read just like mine did. It was almost like a rewriting of it. So I was to think, oh, maybe the first time the person was just shy and didn't say much, but now it's showing its real colors. But no, now it was mirroring, because it didn't have anything to say on its own, so it copied what I said. And they try that a lot because it makes us think we're in tune with the other person. And then a few words regarding this depth thing. I want to clarify a few things. It doesn't count for depth when you're dealing with a cluster B creature who's done something horrific they shouldn't have done. When you ask them, what happened? What did you do? And they give you a long list of lies. They go into extreme detail in these lies, and that's one of the giveaways, because you think in real life, people's situations aren't that detailed. They'll go into all kinds of unnecessary details. That does not count as depth. That's their damage control. That's their attempt at saving face when they're caught lying. And remember, they're very experienced at lying, so they will easily keep a straight face when you've caught them red-handed and still try to convince you that you're mistaken. Another example I thought of that does not count either as depth would be if you saw the movie American Psycho. There's a scene where Patrick Bateman is talking about music, and this hits home to me because I talk about music all the time. But when I listen to Patrick Bateman's little monologue about Huey Lewis and the News and other music, his delivery, although full of words, is very superficial. It almost sounds like he memorized a bunch of reviews, because it doesn't really give you any insight into Patrick Bateman as a person, because as he tells you in the movie, there's nobody there. He tries to make it look like he's just like you are, and he talks about the music, probably from memorizing the reviews. So just to clarify that, so if you've got an elaborate liar, or a person who recites a bunch of pre-written nonsense, doesn't count as depth. Depth is where you really get to know the person inside. that the things that they're saying reveal who they are as a person, and you see it consistently over a series of multiple situations where they're all consistent, or very consistent.
Well, look at you. You know who I am.
I'm the Narcopath, and I'm here once again to tell you a few more confessions. I know this one's long overdue. I'm here to explain it to you. No hard feelings. When we first met, you'd never seen me before in the city, and I was carefully assessing you, and I found that you were the one for me. Now, I tell you that in a romantic way, but in reality, you had a lot of things I could use.
You had a good job, you had a nice house, you had money. I have none of it.
I just tried to make up for it with my charm, which worked some of the time. But I know that when it was all over and I discarded you, you were devastated. I'm hearing from others what you've said, and evidently it really bothered you. You had your family and your friends and your workplace in your hometown where I met you. And I came up with a brilliant idea to move across the country. The reason I did that was because you had way too many friends, way too much family. Some of them were starting to see through me, and I couldn't have that. So I came up with a fairy tale romance. Figured we could move away to Alaska together and live happily ever after. And you were going along with it. Problem was, I changed. Once I got you away from your family, well, that's what I do. I try to isolate my prey. I'm a predator. I accept it. I preyed upon you. Fine, I said it. I wanted you to be without a support system, because some of the stuff I was putting you through, I knew some of your intelligent family and friends would know and see right through what I was doing. Well, I couldn't have them around. That's why I found a remote location and suggested we move there together, just the two of us. You were all for it at first. It's just, I did, what do they call it? What's the second phase called, TJ?
Devalue.
I started to devalue you, but I waited. You noticed I didn't do any of the devaluation until I had you in our home together with no support system anywhere, and you wonder why your phone quit working? I'm the one. I disabled it anytime I could because I didn't want you talking to those family members because they were going to turn you against me. So, I know it devastated you. Obviously, you're fine now because I'm gone. Hopefully, you patched everything back up with your family and friends.
Hi, I'm sure you remember me. I'm gonna do one for you.
Somehow you made the way for me.